Can you get a little closer if you don't mind?
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillahi amma ba'd. A very common mistake that many people make when they give someone quote-unquote shahada, bring someone into Islam, they tend to give a long and extensive lecture. 30 minutes, 45 minutes, and an hour long. And oftentimes when they give this talk or this speech, as if they're intentionally or unintentionally discouraging the person from accepting Islam. They ask him two or three times, are you sure you want to do this? You realize what you're doing? Do you know what you're getting yourself into? Do you understand Islam? Do you know that you have to do this? You have to shave this? You have to wash? You have to change? You have to. They give him a long, extensive list of serious, concerning questions. And perhaps a person could think, I don't want to be a Muslim. Or a person could die in the midst of that long speech and that long talk. And this comes from a lack of knowledge with regards to living in the lands of Islam and living in the lands of other than Islam. If someone accepted Islam and they did something, they drank alcohol, they continued to be with their girlfriend, whatever the case may be, what's going to happen to them? There is no had. There is no Islamic penal code. There's no Islamic criminal law. And which a person, I didn't know that my hand could be cut off if I stole. I didn't know that I would be whipped for drinking alcohol. I didn't know I would be stoned to death if I was once married and I committed fornication or adultery. So we have to realize that the shahada is getting a person to testify to faith. What the person does afterwards, what the person truly believes in their heart, it is not our job. Our job is to call them, to invite them, and to allow them to become our brother or our sister in Al-Islam. So therefore, bidding that to Allah, you can repeat after me with a few brief basic words. I'm sure you've read about Islam. I'm sure you understood things about Islam. We just repeat after me first, and then we give perhaps a brief explanation of what we said, inshallah ta'ala. So I'm going to say it first in Arabic, and then you repeat after me word for word in English, and then bi'idhni ta'ala, you will be our brother in faith, inshallah ta'ala. So you say, Ashhadu.
An.
La.
Ilaha.
Illa.
Illa.
Allah.
Allah.
Wa ashhadu.
Anna.
Muhammadan.
Rasulu.
Allah. Which basically means that you believe in your heart, no matter how much knowledge or how little knowledge you have, but you believe based off of what you have of knowledge, you testify with your tongue that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord of the heavens and the earth, the creator of me and you and all of the human beings, is the only one who should be your deity of worship. The only one true God that you worship, that you submit to, that you love with all of your heart. And Allah, God Almighty, He chose men, and He took these men, He educated them, He revealed things to them, and He made them messengers, the last of the messengers, the best of the messenger to the white and the black, the yellow and the red, the man and the woman is a man whose name is Muhammad. And this is what we call Kalimut Tawheed, or the Shahada. You've now accepted Islam. Alhamdulillah, you're our brother in Islam. We welcome you. MashaAllah, barakallahu fiqh. Best decision of your life. May Allah bless you. Ameen.
What's his name?
Richard.
Brother Richard. Inshallah. Welcome, Brother Richard. Inshallah. So my advice to you, Brother Richard, alhamdulillah, is first and foremost to realize what just happened.
Yeah.
A tremendous blessing. And the thing that's going to keep you firm on Islam, keep you happy in Islam, and allow you to give the gift that was being given to you tonight is that you learn.
Yes.
And you seek knowledge. Everything about Islam is based off of knowledge. And everything outside of Islam is based off of ignorance. Everything in Islam is based off of light. And everything outside of Islam is based off of darkness. So learn, read, study. Don't just be complacent with learning the basics. Be the nice subhanahu wa ta'ala. And hopefully one day people will say the same thing to you, which you just said to us about speaking Arabic. As he said, it was a time in which he didn't speak Arabic.
Yeah.
It was a time in which people used to laugh at me trying to speak Arabic. He can tell you. Alhamdulillah. Barakallahu fiqh. Marhaba.
I was in Indica. You have a flyer?
Yeah.
Okay. You have a flyer? Waraka. My neck? Tie. Tie. Abu Naila. Okay. Zakhallah khair shit. No. Alhamdulillah. Zakhallah fiq. عندي خلاص بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على عبده ورسوله نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد Flyer says Busy yourself with that which is beneficial. Reported by Imam Muslim, number 6945. Speakers, Mufti, Muhammad Ibn Muneer, Ali Davis, Sayyid Abu Sajid. The first two speakers, who are brothers in Islam, first and foremost, colleagues in seeking knowledge, secondly, and last but not least, personal friends, Abu Zaina, and Abu Sajid, may Allah bless them both and increase them both. They spoke to you on two very important topics, two very relevant and plausible topics in 2017. And the first is reasons behind the difference of opinion among the ulama. Why do the scholars differ? Bringing up, first and foremost, the reality that the scholars do differ. And this is one of the biggest problems between many of the things that we suffer from. Turning issues in which there's clear-cut difference of opinion into issues of ijma', consensus. And when you mention the word consensus, obviously your opponent or your enemy is stuck in a narrow corner. A narrow corner. I'm say all of the ulama say this, and you're the only one who's taking a different view. Or the exact opposite, in which we have an issue in which the people of knowledge have come to consensus. No one said nothing else. There are only two views, or one view, or three views, not a fourth view. And then a person says the exact opposite. And it also puts the opponent in a narrow corner. This is one of the reasons behind many of the problems and the cancers that we suffer from in 2017 with regards to Muslims, Islam, and with regards to the field of Dawah. So the reality that the people of knowledge differ, and the people of knowledge, their difference of opinion, your understanding of it, reasons behind it, how to behave, how to conduct with it, is going to be based off of the level of your knowledge. If you have a lot of knowledge, a lot of fiqh, then you're going to know how to behave, how to deal with the khilaf of the ulama in a more thorough manner. If you have a little bit of knowledge, a little bit of fiqh, your Arabic language is weak, and the list goes on, your stance, your understanding, your position to ijma' to khilaf is going to be very difficult, very confusing. So this is a very important and pertinent topic. Secondly was the introduction to the rules of inheritance. Science in a field of discipline in Islam, a field of study, in which many of the ulama said nisful ilm. It says it's half of knowledge. Half of knowledge. And that is because it is the knowledge which is the corridor or the gateway or the bridge between this life and the hereafter. And also the knowledge of inheritance is a deep concept of justice. Justice, and in some cases, equality. In which the people are to be treated equally. And in other cases in which the people are not treated equally, but at least there is justice. That the man gets a double portion than the female. That isn't equality. They aren't equal. But it isn't a means of injustice. The woman is not oppressed. So that is a major staple concept in Islam. Justice. And justice is only based off of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says and commands. Yusikum Allahu. Allah is the one that gives you the wasiyah regarding your wealth. And also the concept of the worthy or the lack of worth of the worldly life. All of the money that you have, that you amass, that you pile up, that you work so hard, so long for, must leave you. And it will go to the hands of someone, in most cases, who isn't going to remember you, who isn't going to pray for you. And the family members that cry, that are bereaved, your wife, your children, so on and so forth, as Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali, rahimahullah ta'ala, stated, he says they're only crying because of their loss. And they're not actually crying because you're in the grave being squeezed. Not necessarily being punished, not necessarily being tortured, but at least being squeezed. As the Prophet ﷺ said about Sa'd ibn Mu'adh radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says, لو نجا أحد من ضجة القبر نجا منه هذا. He says, if someone was safe from the firmness, the snugness of the grave, it would have been Sa'd ibn Mu'adh. So your wife at your deathbed, your children, your brothers, your students, your teachers, whoever your friends and associates are, in most cases, they're not actually crying because of you being questioned. Is he going to be firm? Is he going to answer the question properly? Will he be punished? Sins, debts, backbiting, tailbearing, and the list goes on. They're crying because I lost my husband. I lost my son. I lost my father. I lost my friend. I lost my teacher. They're bereaved because of their personal loss, in most cases. So the concept of inheritance is a major and staple part of the deen with regards to the usul, as we just proved. Justice, hereafter, life, death, and also the actual fiqhiyat, the rulings of the sharia, a sixth, a fourth, an eighth, etc. We all know the famous hadith in which Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was in charge of the Muslims, and it was during the Hajj season. We all know the famous hadith in Sahih Muslim, and we know that Umar radiallahu anhu was harsh, he was severe, he was stern, he wasn't a joke. He was a serious man who demanded and requested all of your respect. So he put one of the Muslims in charge of the people of Mecca. Now just think about it, if you made Hajj, if you made Umrah, how many Muslims are there? How many people are there? The one who's in charge of the people of Mecca, he must have the following characteristics. Number one, he has to be learned. Number two, he has to be mentally strong, physically strong. He must have character, he must have integrity. And very important, he must or he should come from a thorough background. He should be quote unquote high born. He shouldn't be low-born. He shouldn't be from the peasantry. Because if someone is low-born, then it's another excuse for them not to follow him and not to look to him with respect. And it is what Hiraql asked Abu Sufyan. Where does this man Muhammad come from? Is he high-born or is he low-born? Abu Sufyan, even though he was a mushrik at that time, he hated the Prophet ﷺ, he says that he's from the best of the best. He says, وَكَذَلِكَ الرُّسُلْ. He says, and that is the case of the true messengers. They are sent from the cream of the crop, the best of their people. So therefore, this man that Umar put in charge had these characteristics in brief. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he left Mecca and he went to a region which is present even in this day called Usfan. And when Umar radiallahu anhu was there, all of a sudden, guess who he saw? He saw his Khalifa. He saw his governor, the one that he placed in charge to be looking after the affairs of the Muslims in Mecca. So obviously, Umar radiallahu anhu is saying, what are you doing here? I'm here, I left you in charge of the people there. So the man is afraid, but the man, he had confidence in what he said and what he did. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he says, Man walayta ala ahlil wadi. He says, who did you leave in charge of the people of Mecca? Who did you leave in charge of the people of the valley? He says, walaytu alayhim ibn Abza. He says, I put in charge of them a man whose name is Ibn Abza. The first question that Umar had, Waman ibn Abza. He says, and who is this man, the son of Abza? He says, Mawlan min al mawali. He says, he's a freed slave. He's a manumitted slave. In other words, he used to be a slave, so in most cases, he isn't high-born. In most cases, he isn't learned. In most cases, he isn't this and he isn't that. He's looked down upon in the society because he used to be a slave. Even if he came from a noble tribe or a great clan, if he was captured, he was taken and sold as a slave. So the people automatically want to look at him with scorn and disdain. We're not listening to you. You used to be a slave. Who are you to tell us what to do? We're not going to obey you. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he says, وَلَيْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ مَوْلًا. He says, you put an ex-slave in charge of all of the Muslims coming from Yemen, from Abyssinia, from Egypt, from this place. For Hajj, you put in charge of them an ex-slave? He says, Naam ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. He says, yes, O commander of the faithful. In other words, relax, please. Don't hit me yet. Don't flog me yet. Don't be too hasty. He says, yes, O Amir al-Mu'mineen. So the man, he then said to Umar, he says, like, in other words, how did you do this? He says, Naam ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. Innahu qari'un li kitabillah. Alimun bil fara'id. He says, I put him in charge for two reasons and only two reasons. Not what he looks like, not his lineage, not his genealogy, nothing like this. Who knows him? Two things, O Amir al-Mu'mineen. Number one, he is a reciter of Allah's book. He has knowledge. He has capability to recite the Quran. Secondly, he is a learned man of the rules of inheritance. He has fiqh of this science. So that's why I put him in charge. Umar radiallahu anhu, perhaps he was angry, perhaps he was upset, perhaps he was jealous for Allah's deen. All of those emotions, they immediately, instantly went away from him. And he said, Sadaqa nabiyukum sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inna allaha la yarfa'u bihadha kitabi aqwaman wa yada'u bihi akharin. Okay, man qala alayhi salatu wasalam. Umar said, indeed, your prophet has spoken the truth. Indeed, Muhammad was a truthful person. He says that Allah will take some people and he will raise them through the Quran, and he will take other people and he will lower them and humiliate them through the Quran. He said this to this man. This is the reason why Umar passed on the hadith. Ex-slave is the leader. Someone who's highborn of nobility is now the subject for no other reason except for the Quran and except for the rules of inheritance. So this is the status in brief of the rulings of al-mawarith. Okay, how much, who do you give, who can't you give, how is the money dispersed, etc. It's a major field of study. So therefore, may Allah Azza wa Jal reward them both for what they have given of fa'ida, of benefit, and of enlightenment. The lecture, it says here, busy yourself with that which is beneficial. The lecture, it made me very happy, and also made me very sad, especially when I looked at the itinerary. Rulings or reasons behind it, what am I differing? A brief background of the rules of inheritance and introduction, and a detailed look inside or into innovation. It made me happy because my brothers in Islam who are older than me, they had enough respect and good thoughts of me to invite me to be one of their speakers. That's first and foremost. Also, I get a chance to meet many of my brothers for the sake of Allah's promise, some I haven't seen in over 10 years. Many brothers, walillahil hamd, when I left, they were young teenagers, aspiring. Now they've went overseas, learned the Quran, learned Arabic, and they start giving benefit to other people. Walillahil hamd. So this makes me very happy. But the reason or the thing that made me sad is that why wasn't more attention, more focus given on the actual title of the lecture, which is a piece of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's speech. It's a noble hadith as it clearly states on the flyer. Ihris ala ma yanfa'uka. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, be diligent, work hard, be eager, be earnest, upon that which is good, no. Upon that which is a benefit, no. That's not what the hadith says. It says, عَلَى مَا يَنْفَعُكَ, that which benefits you. So I feel humbly, more attention and more time, more focus, more energy, more efforts should have been placed on this one hadith. And it's more than enough to have a series of lectures on the concept of إِحْرِسْ عَلَى مَا يَنْفَعُكَ. Work hard. What does that mean to have hirs, to work hard? And what does it mean upon that which is a benefit to the Muslims, a benefit to the leaders, to the scholars, to the rulers? No. The hadith says, عَلَى مَا يَنْفَعُكَ, that which is a benefit to your own soul, first and foremost. So, bi-idhnillahi subhanahu wa ta'ala, we want to shed some light on this, the importance of the topic, the importance of this lecture and of this title. I want to share with you some words of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala regarding this. He says, قال شيخ الإسلام رحمه الله وقد قيل إن قوله ولهم عذاب مقيم إشارة إلى ما هو لازم لهم في الدنيا والآخرة من الآلام النفسية غما وحزنا وقسوة وظلمة قلب. He says here, Allah Azza wa Jal, he says in Surah Al-Ma'idah, speaking about the believers, speaking about the disbelievers, speaking about paradise, and talking about the hellfire, he says, وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ مُقِيمٌ, and they have an everlasting punishment. Allah says, وَلَهُمْ, they, the kuffar, the mushrikeen, the munafiqeen, عَذَابٌ مُقِيمٌ, they have a punishment that isn't temporary, it doesn't come, it doesn't go, it isn't slighting and lessen, it says that it is everlasting. Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah, he says, وَقَدْ قِيلَ, he says, some of the people of knowledge, some of the sahaba, some of the tabi'een, some of the ulama who came afterwards, they have said, is that this hadith is pointing to the fact that the kuffar, the munafiqeen, the kafirin, and those who imitate them. The Prophet informed us is that we will imitate the Jews and we will imitate the Christians. No matter how stupid, how foolish their acts may be, even going into the hole of a lizard, we would follow them therein. So therefore, if the kuffar have this, and if the Muslims imitate the kuffar, then they're going to get a piece of what they got. He says this verse, according to some of the people of knowledge, it means, or is it an ishara? Allah is pointing and showing us something, is that they have, he says, al-alam al-nafsiyya. He says they have these major means of pain and agony in their souls. They're always in a constant state of pain, agony, and suffering. The kuffar, they have an eternal punishment. In other words, not just in the hereafter, not just in the hellfire, but in this hayat dunya, they're always in pain. They're always in suffering. They're always in agony. How is this? He says, ghamman. He says, sadness, grief, anxiety, depression. And he says, darkness of the heart. The heart being muzlim. No light, no illumination whatsoever. He then says, rahimahullah ta'ala, إلى أن قال وللكفر والمعاصي من الآلام العاجلة الدائمة ما الله به عليم ولهذا تجد غالب هؤلاء لا يطيبون عيشهم إلا بما يزيل العقل ويلهي القلب من تناول مسكر. He says here, for this reason, you find that the kuffar and the mushrikeen and the kafirin, the munafiqeen, the fasiqeen, he says in most cases they're never happy. And they don't actually enjoy their lives. They don't actually enjoy their lives. He says, and that is why they always need a means of amusement or means of intoxication. It's always something that they need to stimulate their minds and to keep them off of the bitter reality of their horrible, terrible, wretched lives. Let's think about our country, our city, 2017. Drugs, how many types of drugs are there? Alcohol, how many types of alcohol are there? Music, sports, personalities, celebrities. Newsfeed, Twitter, Instagram, this one, that one, Facebook, Fulan, Alana, he died, he's born, he did this, he broke a record, he won, he lost. In other words, there's never a time in which you're just natural, in which you're just actually thinking and reflecting. But because you're in so much pain and so much agony, you have to constantly be drugged up. Like someone in the hospital that was shot up, his body was riddled with bullets. Someone that was in a horrible car accident, he's on constant what? Why is that? Because the pain is so severe. So they have to constantly keep his body stuffed and full pump with drugs. So he doesn't realize this agonizing or excruciating pain. So Sheikh Hussein Taymiyyah, he says this is the case with regards to the souls, the hearts, and the minds of the kuffar. They're always in a state of agony, so they have to drink. They have to smoke. They have to watch. They have to play. They have to listen. They have to be engaged in someone else's life. Someone else's legacy, someone else's problems, to keep their minds off of their what? Their own problems that they don't have the ability to bear. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, he then says, with regards to drinking, with regards to intoxication, and with regards to listening to things, وَبِإِزَاءِ ذَٰلِكَ قَوْلُهُ فِي الْمُؤْمِنِينَ أُولَٰئِكَ سَيَرْحَمُهُمُ اللَّهُ. He says, and this is totally contrast to what Allah Azza wa Jalla said about the believers. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the believers. So let's just stop. And let's just reflect. Why should you work hard and be diligent upon that which is a benefit for yourself? That which is good for your own soul? That which helps you out as an individual, as a person? And then we have another way of looking at the hadith, or just the concept of working hard, being diligent upon something that isn't a benefit for your own self. And in most cases, when you follow people, you follow things, listening, watching, it's because you're miserable yourself. And that's why a celebrity, whether it's an entertainer, a musician, in most cases an actor, they can't be humble. But they have to have a certain type of pride and arrogance and conceit. Because if I was humble and if I was basic, no one would what? No one would follow me. Because I'm just like them. I'll be a loser just like they are. But I have to stick out my chest and put up my head to give them a reason to be engaged with what I'm doing. So the general concept of happiness, the general concept of peace of your mind, your soul, your heart as a Muslim, a staple part of that is you doing two things. Number one is that you work hard. Number two is that you seek the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the key, the bridge between these two points is that the thing must be a benefit for your own self, for your own nafs. Khayran, inshallah. Let's go up idhna subhanahu wa ta'ala to what Imam Muslim, rahimahullah, he says in his Musnad al-Sahih, bi'idhna ta'ala, قال الإمام مسلم رحمه الله تعالى في مسنده الصحيح حدثنا أبو بكر بن أبي شيبة وابن نمير قال حدثنا عبد الله بن إدريس عن ربيعة بن عبد الرحمن عن محمد بن يحيى بن حبان عن العرج عن أبي هريرة قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم المؤمن القوي خير وأحب إلى الله من المؤمن الضعيف وفي كل خير احرص على ما ينفعك واستعن بالله ولا تعجز When asabaka shay'un fala taqul law anni fa'altu kadha lakana kadha wa kadha walakin qul qadrullahi wa ma sha'a fa'ala fa inna law taftahu 'amala ash-shaytan aw kama qala alayhi as-salatu was-salam. Imam Muslim, he has a chapter in the book of Al-Qadr. The chapter in a book or the book of Al-Qadr. He gives you his isnad that goes back to A'raj, to Abu Huraira, in which the Messenger of Allah, alayhi salatu wasalam, he said the following words. Listen carefully. Al-mu'min al-qawi khayrun wa ahabbu ila Allah min al-mu'min al-da'if. He says the strong believer, the powerful believer, the formidable believer, the solid believer, the tough believer, khayrun wa ahabbu ila Allah. He is better. She is better. And they are also more fond, more loved, more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, min al-mu'min al-da'if, than the weak believer, the feeble believer, the shaky believer, the believer that isn't so rough and isn't so tough, that doesn't have the necessary strength and power. Wafi kullin khayr. The Prophet ﷺ, he says, however, even though this one is strong, this one is weak, this one is better, this one is superior, this one is inferior, however, wafi kullin khayr. There is good in all of them. There's good in all of them. Even though he's better, even though she's better, it's still good in them both. The Messenger of Allah, alayhi salatu wasalam, he then says the following words. Ihris ala ma yanfa'uka. He says, work hard. Be diligent. Ala ma yanfa'uka. Upon that which benefits you and that which helps you. Wasta'in billah. Seek Allah's help. Wa la ta'jaz. And never make yourself weak. Never be a weakling. Never be afraid. Never be scared. Never be someone who's pessimistic. Never be a defeatist. Never shoot yourself in the foot before you take a step. La ta'jaz. Don't deem yourself weak and incapable, and you actually have the strength and you have the capability to do what you want to do. As long as you do the first two key steps. Number one, diligence. You have to work hard. Number two, you have to seek the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you seek Allah's help without working hard, no benefit. If you work hard, but you don't seek Allah's help, no benefit. And last but not least, you could spend your entire life, 20 years, 30 years, working hard, seeking Allah's help, but it was never, ever beneficial. You wasted your life. Why did you waste your life? How did you fail to realize that what I've been doing as a Muslim over the last 10 years, 15 years, wasn't beneficial? Because of lack of proper knowledge. Lack of the necessary fiqh fi deen. To determine and to discern what is beneficial and that which isn't beneficial. The Messenger of Allah, alayhi salatu wasalam, he then says, وَإِنْ أَصَابَكَ شَيْءٌ فَلَا تَقُلْ لَوْ أَنِّي فَعَلْتُ كَانَ كَذَا وَكَذَا. And if something happens to you, if you fall, if you fail, if you don't reach the top, if you don't complete, if you don't finish, if you get divorced, if you lose a loved one, if you lose a limb, if something happens to you, then do not say the following words. Do not say, beware of saying, man, I shouldn't have done that. Why did I go here? Why did I marry Fulana? Why did I listen to this one? Why? Don't say that. Don't say, only if. Why not? Why shouldn't you do this? The Prophet, he says, before he answered the question, why not to say those words, he says, he went to the Messenger of Allah, he says, walakin. He says, however, you should say something else. And it's a major principle we want to rush too quick with regards to the hadith. لا نحب نستبق الحديث. Okay, we're going to get into the sharh of the hadith. But a major Islamic principle, and that is when I say, don't sit like that, Yaqi. Don't sit like that. Don't sit like that. Yeah. Why'd you change how you sat? Did I tell you how to sit?
No.
But I told you what not to do.
Yeah.
I can't just leave you like that. Don't sit like this. I say, don't sit like that, but sit like this.
Yeah.
In other words, I tell you something is haram, something is disliked, something is bad, something is negative, something is against the sunnah, somebody's a deviant. Now I have to do what? A substitution. I have to give you a replacement because you have to sit somehow. You have to learn. You have to do something. You have to like something in life. You have to make some type of verbal statement. So whenever the Prophet ﷺ told the Sahaba not to do a thing, to avoid swearing by their forefathers, when the Messenger of Allah ﷺ told them not to divorce your wives like this, don't say she's like your mother's back. And so on and so forth. Allah Azza wa Jal and the Rasul, they always give us that which is called al-badil al-salih. They give us a suitable substitution. Pay close attention to the precision of the words. Al-badil al-salih. Lays al-badil fa'asb. A suitable substitution. Because I can give you a substitution, but it isn't suitable. It isn't practical. I say, you should sit in the class laying on your back. That's not suitable, but it is a what? It is a substitution, but it isn't what? It's not salih. La yasluh. So I have to give you something that is possible, practical, and plausible, and that's also good and easy for you to do. So the Messenger of Allah, he says, don't say lo. Don't say if I only, I should have, I would have, so on and so. Don't say these words. He says, however, you should say, Qadr Allah. This is what Allah had decreed. It was written. Whether I went, whether I didn't go, whether I agreed, whether I disagreed, it was written before I was created. And then the Messenger of Allah, alayhi salatu wasalam, he then tells you about the sour fruit, the bad consequence of you doing this. فَإِنَّ لَوْ تَفْتَحُ عَمَلَ الشَّيْطَانِ. Because when you say lo, only if I had, if I didn't, I shoulda, woulda, coulda, he says that opens up the doors of shaitan. That opens up the doors of the shaitan. So this is the entire hadith in Sahih Muslim. The statement, busy yourself with that which is beneficial, is only a piece. It's only a selection of a larger hadith. Everybody understand? It's only a selection of a what? Of a larger hadith. Everybody understand this? Tayyip. Now let's move on to Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala. He says, فتضمن هذا الحديث الشريف أصولا عظيمة من أصول الإيمان أحدها أن الله سبحانه موصوف بالمحبة وأنه يحب حقيقة الثاني أنه يحب مقتضى أسمائه وصفاته وما يوافقها فهو القوي ويحب المؤمن القوي وهو وتر يحب الوتر وجميل يحب الجمال وعليم يحب العلماء ونظيف يحب النظافة ومؤمن يحب المؤمنين ومحسن يحب المحسنين وصابر يحب الصابرين وشاكر يحب الشاكرين ومنها أن محبته للمؤمنين تتفاضل فيحب بعضهم أكثر من بعض ومنها أن سعادة الإنسان في حرص على ما ينفعه في معاشه ومعاده والحرص هو بذل الجهد واستفراغ الوسع فإذا صادف ما ينتفع به الحريص كان حرصه محمودا وكماله كله في مجموع هذين الأمرين أن يكون حريصا وأن يكون حرصه على ما ينتفع به فإن حرص على ما لا ينفعه أو فعل ما ينفعه بغير حرص فاته من الكمال بحسب ما فاته من ذلك فالخير كله في الحرص على ما ينفع ولما كان حرص الإنسان وفعله إنما هو بمعونة الله ومشيئته وتوفيقه أمره أن يستعين به ليجتمع له مقام إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين فإن حرصه على ما ينفعه عبادة لله ولا تتم إلا بمعونته فأمره بأن يعبده وأن يستعين به ثم قال ولا تعجز. Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, this beautiful hadith, this honorable hadith, these wonderful words of the Prophet, this terrific paragraph, he says, تَضَمَّنَ أُصُولًا عَظِيمَةً مِنْ أُصُولِ الْإِيمَانِ. It gives us, it teaches us major fundamental practices, major fundamental principles of Iman. And this hadith, in Ibn Qayyim's words, it shows us the richness of the Sunnah, how beautiful the Sunnah is. One hadith, an entire book can be written in its explanation and in its interpretation. A person may give an hour lecture, 45 minute lecture, 2 hour lecture. A person may write an entire book, and it's no barakah in the book. No barakah in the speech. It's nothing tangible, nothing practical, let alone something that's a asl, a qaida, a maxim, something that's solid, let alone the specific details and the specific fawaid and ahkam. So the Messenger of Allah's words were the most rich words. And that's why he said, بُعِثْتُ بِجَوَامِعِ الْكَلِمِ. He says, Allah has sent me with the laconic speech, the words that are wholesome, comprehensive, and thorough. Hassan al-Basri, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said that the Messenger of Allah's the words that he was sent with, that were جَوَامِع of two types. Those that are in the Quran, and those that are in the hadith of the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam. So this one hadith, Ibn Qayyim, he says, it teaches us the following points. Number one, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the attribute of love. Subhanahu azza wa jal. Haqiqatan. And it's real. It's not figurative. It doesn't mean that Allah will bless someone and guide someone and reward someone. No. Rather, Allah's reward and Allah's mahabba are two different characteristics. La shak min lawazim al-mahabba al-in'am. From the requirements of Allah loving someone is that He will reward someone. But they're not the same. They're not the same. And if you negate Allah's love and say that it's figurative and it really doesn't mean Allah loves because human beings love, then human beings, they also give jaza. They also reward people. What did Usama ibn Zayd narrate? That the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is quoted to have said, مَنْ صَنَعَ إِلَيْكُمْ مَعْرُوفًا فَقَالَ لِفَعِهِ جَزَاكَ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا فَقَدْ أَحْسَنَ الثَّنَاءَ. You tell somebody what? جَزَاكَ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا. may Allah reward you, or I give you something, a gift for what you did for me. So you run from one thing here, and you fall into the exact same thing in another place. And this is anyone who goes against the words of the Messenger of Allah, no matter who he is. When he doesn't follow what Muhammad said, what Muhammad taught, he's going to contradict him or herself, whether he realizes it or whether he realizes it not. So the first point from this hadith is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has love, and it's real love. Athani, number two. أَنُّهُ يُحِبُّ مُقْتَضَى أَسْمَائِهِ وَصِفَاتِهِ وَمَا يُوَفِقُهَا. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he loves based off of his names and his attributes. Allah loves his slaves based off of that which agrees with his names and his attributes. Allah is beautiful and he loves beauty. Allah is all-knowing and he loves people who have ilm. Allah is al-Qawi al-Aziz, al-Jabbar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most powerful and he loves Muslims who are powerful inwardly and outwardly, physically, mentally, spiritually powerful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is tayyib. He's the most pure, al-Quddus. He's the most clean and he also loves cleanliness. He loves purity. He loves purification and the list goes on. So Allah azza wa jal, he is shakir, Ibn Qayyim says. Allah thanks. Allah appreciates. And also Allah loves those who are thankful and those who are grateful and those who are appreciative. Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah, he says number three, the third major faida from this hadith is that Allah's love for the believers isn't on one level. All of the believers in general are beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of them, as long as they have iman. But there's some of Allah's believers who have or enjoy more of Allah's love than others. And the reason why Allah loves one slave more than another is not his background, is not his father, not his tribe, not his clan. Now, what part of the city he comes from, what country he comes from, what he looks like, dark skin, fair skin, no. Allah loves the slave based off of the slave's iman. And the iman is the criterion for the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as it clearly states in the Quran al-Kareem. Ibn al-Qayyim, he then says, and is the highlighting point from the hadith, the fourth asl, the fourth fundamental principle from this hadith, is that a human being will only be successful in this life and in the hereafter. The human being can only be a winner if he does the following things. Number one, he has to work hard. If you think it's going to be easy and sweet and simple, then you can't win. Not in the dunya, not in hereafter. If you think that your success, your prosperity, comes from what you did and what you thought of and how hard you worked and how diligent you were and not based off of what Allah allowed you to do, and how Allah helped you and facilitated the path, you cannot be a winner in this life nor in hereafter. Last but not least, you must work hard. You must seek Allah's help based off of that which is His what? A benefit to who? Nafsika anta, your nafs. And not the next person, not the third, not the fourth, not the fifth. Everybody understand this? And that goes to the beginning of the lecture. About drugs, about music, about smoking things and dancing and singing and all of these things. Because people, they don't work hard upon that which helps themselves. They work hard upon that which nulls and dulls their pain and takes them away from the bitter reality of my miserable, depressing life. Everybody understand this? But if you busy yourself with this principle right here, number one, hard work. Number two, Allah's help. Number three, it has to be beneficial for me first and foremost. You don't have time for the next person and the next man. You don't have time for this and for that. That may be good. That may be fun. That may be nice. But I just don't have what? Just don't have enough time. Because these three things keep me busy 24/7. Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he then says, he must work hard, and his hard work must be upon that which is a benefit for himself. And he will only reach perfection in this life and thereafter based off of that. And when a person has these three tiers, he will have thoroughly implemented and actualized Allah's statement, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ. You alone we worship, O Allah, and you alone we ask for help. We know Ibn Qayyim, he wrote an entire book interpreting this one ayah, which is a sharh of another book, مَدَارِجُ السَّالِكِينَ فِي شَرْحْ مَنَازِلْ السَّائِرِينَ. He wrote an entire book just on this one ayah and all of the things that are included in its meaning. What does it mean to worship Allah alone? And what does it mean to seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's help? Everybody understand this? Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he then says, so therefore Allah commanded him to worship him by being a hard working slave. And this can only be done with the help, the support, and the facilitation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He then said, وَلَا تَعْجَزْ. Don't be weak. فإن العجز ينافي حرصه على ما ينفعه وينافي استعانته بالله فالحريص على ما ينفعه المستعين بالله ضد العاجز فهذا إرشاد أنه قبل رجوع المقدور إلى ما هو من أعظم أسباب حصوله والحرص عليه مع الاستعانة عن أزمة الأمور. He says, then the prophet said, do not be weak. Do not make yourself incapable. And that is because someone who works hard and someone who seeks help in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's no way that he can be weak. It's no way that you can be incapable of what you want and what you're trying to do. It's no way. And that is because Allah has given you intelligence. Allah gave you a brain. Allah gave you a body, a heart, a mind, a soul. Allah gave you physical capability. But that's not enough. It's much more than that. Allah is my support. Allah is my help in the beginning, during the act, and at the end of the act. So how can I lose? Is Allah weak? Is Allah incapable? The human being's mind, the human being's heart, the human being's body. خُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ ضَعِيفًا, Allah says. وَخُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ ضَعِيفًا, man has been created weak in comparison to the heavens. أَأَنْتُمْ أَشَدُّ خَلْقًا أَمِ السَّمَاءِ, in comparison to the heavens, man is weak. With regards to the nature of man's conception, losing control in the act of sexual intercourse, that's a means of weakness. In relation to your skin, your flesh, your nerves, you're weak. But in relation to many other things, in the Quran and the Sunnah, let alone other creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, man is strong. Allah clearly tells us that وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. Allah says, he who created you for sawaka, fa'adalak. Allah, he strengthened you, he straightened you. So if you have the natural strength that Allah gave you, and then you also rely upon Allah, Al-Qawi Al-Aziz, the Prophet is telling you, how can you what? How can you lose? It's no way that you can be a loser unless you don't follow the necessary steps. However, there's something that is hidden from you. There's something that you don't know about. There's something that does not pertain to your strength. It doesn't pertain to your love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is something that is divine, and that is al-maqdur. What has been created, what has been made before you even thought of. You don't know it, I don't know it, and it's Allah's wisdom that He kept it from our knowledge. So therefore, what do you do when something happens to you? I worked hard, I made dua, I prayed to Allah, I did everything in my possible capability to achieve this goal, and I didn't. Because it was what? It was decreed. And don't have regret and remorse. I shouldn't have went with him. I could have, I saw myself, because that opens up the door of shaitan. And what is the door of shaitan? The door of shaitan is the following things. Number one, doubt. Shak. Is there really qadr? Is there actual qadr? Was it really meant to be? Did Allah decree for me to make this sin and to disobey him over and over again and then put me in the hellfire and burn me? It's doubt of shaitan. And then also besides doubt is depression. Person becomes sad and lost. When you're depressed, when you're sad, you can't benefit from anything. You don't want to eat, you don't want to drink, you don't want to do nothing fruitful and productive because you're so sad, you're so depressed. And then the shaitan, he opens up this door, and one door now becomes a gate. And the next thing you know, the gate becomes an entire entrance, a sector, and it's a gaping hole in your iman. And that leads to kufr, waliyadu billah. If you start thinking how, why, when Allah decreed this one, so on and so forth, look what just happened. Look at these people suffering and starving in the world right now as we speak. Allah decreed this to happen? Allah made all of these slaves to go to hell just for me to go to paradise? It's the tricks of the shaitan. So the Prophet says, don't do these things. Don't make these statements. Even though it's permissible to say though. It's permissible to say if in other circumstances, but not in the means of you being displeased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the qadr. I tried, I planned, I prepared, I worked hard. It wasn't meant to be. That is ultimate content. And this is why the places in which there is the least Islam and the places in which there's the most atheism, let alone Christianity, but just atheism, these lands have the highest suicide rates. And you go and you live among the Muslims, whether it's Egypt, whether it's Tunisia, South Africa, Tanzania, Zanzibar, wherever you go in which there's an abundance of Muslims, you find problems among the Muslims. Muslims have riba banks. Muslim women don't wear hijab. They may drink alcohol. There's oppression. There's this and there's that. You may find rape. You may find pedophilia. You may find these things sporadically here and there. But the suicide rate is very, very slim. Especially in comparison to the Western countries. In Europe, the continent of Europe, let alone North America. Do you think this is an accident? It isn't an accident. And that's because all Muslims, no matter what knowledge they have the basic concept of mashallah. They have the basic concept of Qadr, Qadr Allah. Malish. Sorry, it was decreed. That's it, period. And the average person who's a non-Muslim, even though there are non-Muslims who do believe in fate, but those who have no religion, no deen, huh? When something happens, I spent all of these years, all of this money, and it still didn't work. So therefore, suicide. I fell into this sin, I fell into this addiction, I fell into abusing this substance. It's too late to turn back now, so therefore, just take my life. So this hadith is a means of medicine for the dunya and the akhirah. This hadith is a major school, it's a madrasa in itself, for your aqidah, asma'u sifat, for al-qadr, for al-iman, for ibadah, for your own personal well-being. Well-being of your mind, well-being of your heart, well-being of your soul, and well-being of your body. Because the Prophet clearly says, ihris ala ma yanfa'uka. He said, work hard. You want to work out, you want to exercise, you want to eat good, you want to drink good, you want to do this. All of that is included in that which is a what? A benefit for who? For yourself. Everybody understand this? So this hadith, we can spend hours and hours and hours on dissecting it and slicing it and taking relative points in our daily lives. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by His beautiful names and by His perfect attributes to allow us to truly understand this hadith, implement this hadith, practice hadith, and pass on to others. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Jazakum Allah khairan for your time, for your respect. My esteemed brothers in al-Islam, Abu Sajid, Abu Zaina, may Allah bless them. And I mean this from the bottom of my heart. Thanking them for inviting me and giving me a time to share these words of benefit with my brothers and sisters in al-Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala surely knows best. Jazakum Allah khairan. We can say that. We can say that with regard. Let's be patient. Everybody be patient. Allah loves the sabirin. We didn't implement the hadith that. I didn't say what you said was wrong, but I can't say that because it's not time for the Q&A yet. That's why. Khair, inshallah. I don't know how much time we have. We're supposed to stop at 9. Khair, inshallah. Just give us 1 second, bidnai ta'ala. That way we can allow the many people watching online to switch the recording for the open question and answer session. Bidnai subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tayyib. And before we go further, I'm sure that Brother Ali and Brother Saeed, inshallah, I'm sure they can forgive me and pardon me in their big hearts for going against the grain on a selected topic, huh? Innovations in Islam, a detailed discussion, which is a very important topic. But for one reason or another, I thought that this was more appropriate. And Allah knows best. Bismillah. Question says, can we say that depression is a sign of weak iman? Sometimes we can say that clearly, and other times we can't say that clearly. Why do you have depression, and what are you depressed about? Why are you depressed? Based off of what? You're depressed because of material things? Because of worldly gain and loss? Then there lies no doubt you have sorrow about something that you shouldn't have sorrow about in the first place. You shouldn't be busying yourself with these things. You shouldn't be chasing after them, running after them. Huh? That's not your place as a believer. That's first and foremost and brief. And secondly, there could be something that could take place that's a religious issue. Something that's painful, that's hurtful, with regards to iman and the mu'mineen that causes you to be depressed. Thirdly, last but not least, is the general emotion of depression. That's not necessarily a sin. The emotion of anger isn't necessarily a sin. The emotion of lust, of greed, is not necessarily a sin. But the sin comes in that emotion or that thought becoming an idea and a plan, let alone into an actual action. As Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala narrated in the Sahih, he told us about the eyes, about the hands, he told us about the feet. All of these things, he says, وَالْعَيْنَانِ تَزْنِيَانِ. The eyes make zina, the hands, the feet, etc. He says, وَالْقَلْبُ يَتَمَنَّى. And the heart wishes, the heart hopes. وَالْفَرْجُ يُصَدِّقُ ذَلِكَ أَوْ يُكَذِّبُهُ. He says, and the last final step is the sexual organ. The final translation of thoughts, of emotions to deeds is the actual zina. So if you see something or hear something or have a feeling, that's not necessarily a sin. Being depressed initially isn't necessarily a sin, but what the depression leads to. You didn't seek help in Allah. You didn't say the necessary adhkar. You left off the salah. You began to drink. You began to smoke. You shaved your beard. You took off your hijab. You start falling to things that Allah clearly told you to avoid. Now that's a clear what? That's a clear sin. Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu narrated that the Prophet ﷺ, he used to seek Allah's refuge from the following things. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-hammi wal-hazan. He says, O Allah, I seek your refuge, I seek your protection from grief, things about the past. And he says, min al-hammi wal-hazan, future and past. We know that the Prophet ﷺ had the strongest connection with Allah. He was the best of Allah's slaves, yet still he asked Allah to protect him from these things. إِنَّمَا أَشْكُ بَثِي وَحُزْنِي إِلَى اللَّهِ. He said, I complain to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and my huzn, my sadness, my grief about Yusuf alayhi salam, what happened to my son, what you did, what you said, how you conspired against him. Everybody understand this? He says, وَأَعْلَمُ مِنَ اللَّهِ. He says, and I know about Allah that which you don't know. So to just be depressed in the beginning is not a bad thing. The Messenger of Allah salam, he gave advice. He said, لَا تَغْضَبْ. Don't become angry. The ulama, they interpret this hadith to mean the following things. Number one is actually don't get angry. And the second interpretation is don't act upon your anger. Don't execute your anger. Don't translate the emotion of anger into a deed. Because anger is natural. You can't necessarily control that. But if you get mad, don't strike, don't smack, don't curse, don't slander, don't break. Everybody understand this? So we have the concept of implementing the depression, falling weak to the depression. We have the concept of not fighting off the depression and why you're getting depressed and why you're depressed. I'm depressed because the Muslims are getting killed and we're not doing anything about it. That's a good thing. I'm depressed because I lost money or this sister or this brother or so on and so forth. So it has to be detailed. It has to be what? It could be a sign of low iman, and depression could also be a sign of high iman. It could be a sign of what? Strong iman, depending on the thing and what you do. Hopefully that's clear and hopefully that makes sense. Inshallah.
Now, I want to ask a question: is that what is the importance of askar sabaha wa masa with our general life, and as-sabur, is it a part of asimahi wa sifatullah?
Right. With regards to the importance of the supplications in the day and in the night, in the morning, in the afternoon, etc., why are they important? Is it an issue of aqidah? Is it pertaining, or does it pertain to aqidah, etc.? We say the adhkar, the supplications, are of utmost importance to every single Muslim. Not important, not something that's from the deen, it's of utmost importance from the foundations of your iman and of your Islam. And that is because you have been created for one purpose and one purpose only. And that is to worship Allah, the sublime, the exalted, along without any partner. And from Allah's worship is that which anything He tells you to do. And when Allah tells you to do something, it means the following things. Number one, He loves that thing and He's pleased with that thing. So it's ibadah. What did Allah say in the Quran? What did He say to Muhammad? What did He say to the believers? What did He say to the mujahideen when they face their enemies and they stand in rows to fight? Allah says to do what? He mentioned something. Even when they're about to fight, they're about to lose their lives, He told them to mention Allah in abundance. To mention Allah what? In abundance. Because living, dying for Allah is all ibadah. So therefore, for the layman Muslim who doesn't know much, who doesn't understand much, who doesn't know Arabic, I didn't go overseas, adhkar is of utmost importance. And that's because it is the reason why you're breathing, living, and walking and talking, is to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's it. You're not alive for any other purpose. Allah only created you to worship Him, to submit to Him. And from Allah's worship, and from submitting to Him, is يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ ذِكْرًا كَثِيرًا. Allah clearly tells you to remember Him in abundance. Everybody understand this? The student of knowledge. Why are adhkar so important for the student of knowledge? You go overseas, you study, you learn the Quran, you learn the qira'at, you study hadith, you study aqidah, you learn with the scholars, so on and so forth. From the most important pieces of advice that I'm giving right now tonight to every young seeker of ilm is the following things. Number one, learn the Arabic language. Number two, memorize as much of the Quran as you possibly can. Number three, most importantly, learn as much adhkar as you possibly can in America. Before you go to Medina, before you go to Mecca, memorize Hisnul Muslim. Memorize these supplications. Why? For two main reasons. Number one, mentioning and reading, reciting the adhkar, it trains you to memorize, to practice, and to review. What do you say before you go to sleep? Do you stutter? Do you think about it? Yes or no? Right or wrong? What do you do? Or you know the dua by heart? Do you pull out the Hisnul Muslim before you go to sleep?
No.
You say it? By what? By heart. Before you eat, what do you do, Sharif? Before you eat, what do you say? When you finish eating, what do you say? You put on your clothes. In other words, you've memorized the adhkar by heart. Why have you memorized the adhkar so easily, so simply? Because you do what? You repeated them on a daily basis. So this is the training grounds for the talib al-ilm. You want to memorize the Quran? You have to repeat it. You want to memorize the hadith? You have to constantly what? Repeat it and read it over and over again until it's a part of your mind. And it doesn't ever leave your mind. Whether you're sleepy, whether you're tired, whatever it can be, you can quote it. Qala Rasulullah, Qala Rasulullah, Qala Rasulullah. Everybody understand this? And secondly, the student of knowledge is most deserving to have a tight relationship with Allah more than anyone else. And the adab of a talib al-ilm are no adab, no different than the adab of the layman Muslim. But the student is supposed to be elite. He's supposed to be the best from among the best. Every Muslim has to be sincere. Every Muslim has to follow the sunnah. Every Muslim has to read the Quran. Every Muslim has to be pious and humble and brave. But the student of knowledge is supposed to be what? He's supposed to be above, a few notches above the average. Everybody understand this? Let alone an advanced student of knowledge, let alone a scholar. And this is a major problem that we have when a student of knowledge behaves like a layman person in the street. There's no difference between me and you. How I walk, how I talk, what I say, what I do, you can't even tell. That's a problem. The student of knowledge is supposed to be a walking, talking, ilm. He's supposed to be a piece of knowledge on the earth. So therefore, when you learn adhkar, it strengthens your relationship with what? With Allah. And who is in more need of the relationship with Allah than the who? Talib al-ilm. Than who? Student of knowledge. He's supposed to be the one to cure the people, to help the people. So if he's sick, if he's diseased, who can he help? So the adhkar are very important for the talib al-ilm as well. And the list goes on, okay? As far as the asma'u, sifat, and the aqidah, the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hadith, inna lillahi, tis'atan wa tis'een isma, miyatan illa wahida, man a'asaha dakhal al-jannah, okay, man qala alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The authentic hadith, the Prophet says, Allah has 99 names. Man a'asaha, he who memorizes them, enumerates them, counts them, will certainly enter paradise. What are Allah's names? Al-Alim, Al-Ali, Al-Kabir, Al-Mut'al. These are all names of Allah. And every name of Allah has a what? Has a sifa, an attribute. And every attribute has a what? A fi'l, an action. And the list goes on. So one of the main problems that we have as Muslims, and this, I'm going to stop with this point, is that we split things up. They're not to be split up. The Sahaba, they lived upon Islam. Fiqh, Aqidah, Tawheed, it was all one. We come, cut, slice, categorize, and split things up, which ought to be what? One thing. Everybody understand this? Your aqidah is supposed to be clearly manifest in your ibadah. Your ibadah is supposed to be based off of your akhlaq. They're all married together. So there lies no doubt. And this is the benefit of learning Allah's asma wa sifat. If you want to keep disobeying Allah, what is the purpose that you believe in? He sees and hears everything. If you yourself want to be mean and base, you want to be lowly, what is the purpose of you knowing that Allah is above all? But you wish for the you want to be safin in your akhlaq and in your statements. It's a huge problem in your aqidah, whether you say it or not. And just because I say I have the good aqidah, doesn't mean that you actually have the good aqidah. Because you sit down and talk to the Ash'ira, they say they have what? Aqeedah, Ahlul Sunnah. You talk to the Rafida, they're going to say, we're Muslims. And we have the Aqeedah of the Quran. Everybody understand this? Talk is cheap. Talk is cheap. Wallahu alam. Put them online.
Muhammad Harris, please share your insight on holding ties of kinship. As a person living with relatives not particularly practicing or achieving ilm of deen in any form, what is their rights on me? How to implement practically and not to go overboard?
My advice is to look at your own self. Look at your own life. How long were you Muslim? When did you start practicing Islam? Most of us are of the following categories. Not all, but most of us. Number one, those of us who used to be Christian, or Jews, or Hindus, or Buddhists, or just no religion. Money is my religion. Reefer is my religion. Weed is my religion. Women, money, that's my religion. That is my deen. Then Allah blessed you. Allah guided you. He turned you from an ignorant, oppressive, tyrannical person into a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sheikh, did you have that black mark on your head your entire life? He didn't. It was a time in which there was no mark on his forehead. Allah put that mark on his forehead. Everybody understand this? So this is many of us. We used to be other than Muslims. Number two, Umar, Adam, Khalid. We have people that were born Muslim, but I'm 20 years old, I'm 25 years old. The bitter reality, Oase, half of my life, a third of my life, was I what? Didn't have a beard. I worked in a riba bank. I didn't pray. My pants weren't above my ankles. My wife was uncovered, mutabarraja, in the street. And my name was Ali and Ahmed and Mustafa and Abdul Kabir and so on and so forth. Israeli, a Muslim, from a Muslim background. Good Muslim mother, good Muslim father, good household, but no clue about knowledge and practice. That's the second category of us. Those who were born upon Islam, but there was no practice. There was no knowledge. There was no deen, let alone other names and terms that you say and give. It was none of that. It was just being a Muslim, Islam. You don't eat pork. You pray five times a day, surah al-ikhlas, so on and so forth. You have on a kimar. That was it. That was the deen. That's all you knew, and that was all Islam was. Five pillars of Islam. If you memorize Juz Amma, you are a scholar. You're an alim. If you memorize Juz Amma, this is reality. This is reality. The third category are the few individuals that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed to be born Muslim and to be upon the fitrah, remain upon the fitrah from day one. From what? From day one. And I have no doubt in my mind that in this masjid, the brothers and sisters online in Denmark or Nigeria, Mexico, all over the world, I would say that these people are the very few people. And that's why the Sahaba has so much regard for them. لَعَلَّهُمُ الَّذِينَ وُرِدُوا فِي الْإِسْلَامِ فَلَمْ يُشْرِكُوا بِاللَّهِ شَيْئًا. Who are those people that were into paradise, no punishment, no reckoning? Some of them said, لَعَلَّهُمُ الَّذِينَ صَحِبُوا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. Those who were with the Sahaba, or the with the Rasul. And these were the Sahaba who said this. They're talking about Abu Bakr. They're talking about Ali. They're talking about Bilal. They're talking about Khadija. They're talking about Mus'ab ibn Umayr, the early Sahaba. And others, they said, maybe they're those who were born in Islam and they never ever made shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In other words, these people are what? They're few. Everybody understand this? They're muwaffaq. Everybody clear on this? So we have three categories of people. So let's exclude the third category. That's those people that used to be Christians and people that used to be fasaq. People that didn't pray. You were Muslim by name and that was it. What does Allah tell us about this? How does Allah educate us and teach us in the Quran al-Kareem in Surah An-Nisa? Allah addresses the believers who are going out and fighting in Allah's cause to raise Allah's statement. He commands them and he prohibits them from something. And at the end of the command, the end of the prohibition, he gives them the secret and wisdom behind all of it. Those who give you the salam, don't say, lesta mu'minan, that you're not really a true believer. You're only afraid of being fought. You're only afraid of the jizya, you're this and you're that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, don't say that for those who give you the salam. Why not? Kadalikum. Allah says what? Allah says, that is how what?
You were.
You used to be. So your mother that doesn't wear hijab, your father that doesn't grow his beard, he shaves his beard. Before you say it's haram, it's bid'ah, I can't sit at the dinner table, I can't do this, I can't do that. Think about when you were 16, when you were 17, when you were chasing girls, when you were drinking. Think about the tattoo that you can cover up, but Allah knows that it's still there. Think about when you weren't practicing, when you were running wild as a Muslim. Your name was Ali, and you had a girlfriend. Your name was Ali, and you never made salat. You never made sujood. So don't be too hasty. Don't rush too fast and talk about your parents that raised you and that were patient upon your harm and your disrespect. Or let's go even deeper than that. You used to be a Christian. You were a mushrik. You thought Allah was one of three. You thought Allah was in a picture, a man. Allah blessed you. Allah guided you. Allah handed you that gift. And now you monopolize it. And anyone who doesn't do it, like I say, when I say my interpretation, is this and is that and so on and so forth. Obviously, you haven't read this verse in the Quran al-Kareem. You haven't understood it and you haven't applied it. كَذَلِكُمْ كُنْتُمْ Allah says, what? This is how you used to be. Everybody understand this? The Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told the Sahabi, Usama radiallahu anhu, you killed the man after he said, La ilaha illallah? You killed him after he said, La ilaha illallah? If you would have done so, then what would have been the case? He says, فَإِنَّهُ He says, then he would have been in what? Your shoes before you killed him, and the exact opposite. He would go to paradise and you would go to the fire. What do you have to do that? So just reflect on that. If you make the necessary reflection on this concept, I guarantee it's going to slow you down. It's going to force you to pump the brakes just a little bit. Your parents, your family members, and your neighbors. It doesn't mean that you don't enjoy the good and forbid the evil. It doesn't mean that you don't have jealousy for the evil. It doesn't mean that, no. But you have to be real. I have to be patient. Allah is the one who opens up the hearts, not me. The hidayah is not in my hand. I don't have a magic wand to make people obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Myself, I used to be disobedient. And people were what? They were patient with me. I used to be ignorant, and my teacher was patient with me. When I went to school, I didn't know anything. My teacher was patient with me. So you should be patient with the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he loved the Messenger of Allah so much. He has so much love of the Rasul, is that when they slandered, they made gossip. And some of the Sahaba didn't slander Aisha, but they just mentioned the story of what took place between Aisha and the other people. Not because it was his daughter. Pay attention. Abu Bakr wasn't mad because it was his daughter, Aisha. He was upset. He was jealous because it was his close, intimate friend, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he swore to Allah, anyone who slandered the wife of Muhammad, not my daughter, anyone who mentioned the story of the wife of Muhammad, I'm not going to give them any money, no sadaqah, nothing. He made this promise, and Allah Azza wa Jalla, he prohibited him from doing this. فَلْيَعْفُوا وَلْيَصْفَحُوا Allah says, do what? Pardon and turn the other way. Forgive. Why? أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ Don't you love for Allah to forgive you? Wallahu, huh? Allah is most forgiving, most merciful. So just keep this in mind. And if you have this on your mind, it's going to have an effect on how you enjoy the good and how you forbid the evil. It's going to have an effect in how you talk to people if they're your family members. Even when you tell them that something is haram. That's my answer. Wallahu alam. Fadl.
If someone's traveling and if they want to pray salah, this four rak'ah, Dhuhr, Asr, and they come and they catch in the masjid for jama'ah, should that person stay in the back
of the
two rak'ah, or should that person join the
jama'ah? Abdullah ibn Abbas, he was asked this question, and he said to pray with the imam in the complete number of rak'at. Tilka hiya sunnah. He says, that's the sunnah. When the musafir, the traveler, is praying behind a what? Maqim, a resident. Do not stay in the back of the masjid. Do not pray by yourself. Enter into the jama'ah. You are to follow the imam, because it's the only reason why he's an imam to be followed, as the Prophet told us. So don't pray by yourself. Pray with the imam, even if you have a different intention. He's making asr, you're making dhuhr. He's making isha, you're making maghrib. If you have to sit down, if you don't make the tashahud, etc., follow the imam. And make your intentions of praying like the imam is praying, regardless of your specific salah. Everybody understand this? So number one, follow the imam into the salah. Number two, no matter what you're making, make what the imam is making. If you're away from the masjid, if you have your own jama'ah, if you're sick, if you're ill, then you make the salah, combining them and shortening them based off of what you please to do. Wallahu ta'ala, that's in brief. Obviously, time is what? Extremely limited. I'm sure there are many, many questions, let alone I don't know how long the venue is going to be. Being the last panel, I don't want to hog the mic. That was Sajid, huh? Faddle.
Just some advice for people, especially in this particular city, like we're talking about worrying about yourself. the fitness in particular this city, like you shouldn't do this and you shouldn't. How should we? What's advice for us to deal with these people? Because some of my friends that I grew up with, like, we all come from the same place, and the hatred that becomes like, okay, you, some of us shouldn't be in this particular masjid right now listening to this talk.
Listening to me. Yeah. Specifically, let's keep it real. Let's keep it what? خلينا صراحة. طيب تفضل.
But these are people that we grew up with. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like we you in particular, we from the masjid. You understand what I'm saying? So like you see the people and the separation from us. What the, okay? I still love a brother, but I can't deal with you. That's how you feel. What advice do you have to give to us in this city, man? Like, it's just too much. And what advice do you have to give to us about not dealing with those people that have that type of ideology that's just whacked out? You understand what I'm saying? Like,
it's clear. Please, like, first and foremost is we have to agree to disagree.
Come on.
The beginning of your question, I don't necessarily agree with that. It's only here in this city.
No, tell me.
You may know that.
No,
that may not be intentional, but many of us, we may think that.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm not that old, but alhamdulillah, Allah has blessed me to travel to many continents. I've been to several continents, maybe all six, Allahu alam, let alone cities, states, towns. I've been to many, many places in my short life, let alone my classmates, my teachers. They are from every corner of the world. You making this up, Ali? In Mecca, Medina, you have people in your class from Russia, from El Salvador, all over the place. This fitna has, huh? She said to the moon, huh? Allahumma sta NASA. Everybody understand this? This fitna is widespread. Wa'iyadu billah. However, the part that makes it even worse with America, or let's say North America first and foremost, Canada, America, North America, the East Coast, Philadelphia, etc., is that we have a score of problems before Islam. We have a score of problems before Talib al-Ilm, before Dawah al-Salafiyya, before Salafiyya, etc. We have a score of problems. Everybody understand this? Social problems, psychological problems, financial problems, economic problems.
Mental problems.
All types of things. So therefore, the fitna, why is it so powerful and strong? Is one of the reasons, there are many of, is because the fitna has found fertile ground. It's a lush pasture. People are poor. People have an inferiority complex. People have been bred and raised upon jealousy and envy, crab in the barrel mentality. People are bored, they're depressed, they're down, they're out. Not everybody, but we're talking about in general. So therefore, fitna is an alcohol. It's khamr. It's a drug. Feels good, tastes good. It takes me off of my problems. You're a deviant. You're this, you're that, you're kether, fulan. Or let's not deal with the bad guy, with the good guy. And this is, I'm saying it's open. I'm not talking about nobody specific. If the shoe fits, then wear it. But this is a reality. A savior, a hero. Why does everybody like a hero and like a savior? Because the savior, or let's say the hero, he has the courage that the average person what? Don't have. He has the ability. He has the magic flick of a hand to change things that I wish I had, that I wish I could do. So the bad guy and the good guy, they both take me off of the reality of my what? My situation, my problems. So this is one of the reasons why the fitna has been so strong, so powerful here in Philadelphia. Everybody understand this? I want to tell you a brief story. In 2002, I was in Medina. Everybody understand this? I was in Medina. And I won't mention the names specifically, but I'll mention just one name perhaps. I was sitting with Sheikh Abdul Muslim al-Abbad. Back in 2002, it was a secret protocol. A secret protocol. You could not sit with Sheikh Abdul Muslim al-Abbad. Don't study with Sheikh Abdul Muslim al-Abbad. Don't talk about him in public. Don't say anything about him. But don't be caught in his majlis. In 2002, and don't believe this? Don't take it from me. Obviously, in 2017, much different to 2002 with regards to myself. Walillahil hamd. I disobeyed that protocol. I went off and I snuck and I sat in the majlis of Sheikh.